Yeah, welcome everybody, ladies and gentlemen, and dear colleagues. I'm very happy to welcome you here in the Academy building of the Jewish Museum Berlin. And my special welcome, of course, goes to those of you that came from afar and that really had a long way and a long journey to do, literally from the other side of the globe, to join us here. Thank you for undertaking that long journey. And I also wish to thank Pamela Klassen and Monique Scheer for choosing the Jewish Museum as to the third venue for their workshops in their five-year project, Religion and Public Memory in Multicultural Societies. Before both of them will tell you more about this in a minute, let me briefly introduce the Jewish Museum Berlin, particularly to our foreign guests, and give you some orientation about where you are and who we are. The building we are presently sitting in had been Berlin's central flower market until it was reconstructed by Daniel Libeskind to serve various functions and facilities and departments of the Jewish Museum Berlin. Its education department, its library, which you had already seen probably, its archives, and its academy programs. All of this gathered around the Garden of the Diaspora, which you were invited to have a look at, designed by Atelier Balto. And then the second half of the same building, the Children's Museum of the Jewish Museum, is under construction and will open next year. On the other side of the street, you find the building, which we are particularly famous for, Daniel Libeskind's annex to the Baroque building, the former Court of Justice. You will enter the Libeskind building through this Baroque building, and I hope you will have the chance to do so. Although the actual permanent exhibition spaces in the Libeskind building, as well as the temporary exhibition spaces in the upper floor of the Baroque building are both closed presently, there is still quite a lot to see. There's a presentation of objects from our collections related to Holocaust and exile in the basement axes. And in the gallery on the ground floor, you will find an exhibition on contemporary Jewish life in Germany. You shouldn't miss the artistic spaces, some of which are part of Libeskind's architecture, such as the Garden of Exile and the Voided Void. There's the installation by Menashe Kadishman in the largest one of the voids, and the temporary artistic projects by Misha Kubal and James Turrell. Especially don't miss the Turrell. And of course, there's a cafe and a bookstore in the garden. Well, this was the commercial break to make you curious and to join the tour with my colleague Miriam Goldman, which will take place on Saturday morning. As an institution, the Jewish Museum goes back to the Jewish Department of the City Historical Museum of West Berlin after the fall of the wall, which was housed in the Baroque building, by the way. After the fall of the wall and the decision to make Berlin the capital of the United Germany, the original purpose of Libeskind's extension building had been reconsidered and revised. In the end, after a long process, the whole complex was turned into a Jewish museum under the auspices of the then also newly founded Federal Office of Culture and Media. We are now the largest Jewish museum in Germany, I should say, and after Warsaw, which had opened several years ago, the second largest in Europe. In terms of square meters, budget, and staff, our collection had been established rather late, in the late 1970s, and grown since considerably in numbers and in quality. Compared with other Jewish museums, however, today, and with pre-war Jewish museums, size is not the only difference. The fact that we are housed in a modern building is the most obvious one, as most Jewish museums in Germany today are housed in historic buildings. The fact that we are funded by the federal government is the most fundamental one to Jewish museums outside Germany today and to the Jewish museums of the past, which were funded by the Jewish communities or by benefactors from their midst. Clearly, the Jewish Museum Berlin is an institution closely tied to the newly united Germany's national politics of remembrance. The Holocaust is a central point of reference, not just to the architecture of Daniel Libeskind. Remembrance is one of our raisons d'être. However, we are not a Holocaust museum. Its unique architecture and its difficult history made the Jewish Museum Berlin one of the favorite playgrounds for research on memory theory and museum critique. In fact, we work in constellations that create many interesting fields of tension, or rather, let's say, arcs of suspense and energies. We are housed in a building that could be a Holocaust memorial, but we are not a Holocaust museum. We are a national institution, but we are working with communities, as Jewish as well as non-Jewish. Our core topic is German-Jewish cultural history, a very specific topic, but we want to and we have to make it relevant for all our visitors, no matter which background they have. We're dealing with issues of religion, but we are in Germany, in a rather secular society, and many aspects more. You can see from this that the issues addressed in this conference resonate strongly and in many ways with the work in the Jewish Museum Berlin, and that we are faced with questions of religion, remembrance, and reconciliation on a daily basis. This makes us particularly glad to host this conference and to be invited to contribute to the workshops. We're looking forward to this exchange between scholars from universities and museums, an exchange that is vital for both, sharing different perspectives and exploring different forms of knowledge and different ways of producing knowledge. Considering the presently still unequal conditions under which research can take place here and there in the museum and in the university, and considering the fact that research on museums has found its way into the university, I hope that in the future, research will be strengthened also within the museums themselves, and that from there, it will find its way into the university as much as to the larger public. Our wishes for an inspiring workshop will not go without our thanks to our partners, Pamela Klassen from the University of Toronto and Monique Scheer of the University of Tübingen, who initiated the project, to all the speakers and participants, especially to those who came a long way, and to our colleagues in the Jewish Museum who organized the conference, Pea Bürum-Wand, Sitara Veratunga, Caroline Kiel, Antje Gotsch, and Frank Staubesand. Thank you, and now I give to Pamela Klassen.
Good evening, guten Abend. Thank you very much, Frau Bertz, for that introduction. I want to thank all of you for joining us here this evening at the Jewish Museum Berlin. Just to let you know, I'm going to say my introduction in English, and then my colleague, Monique, will say pretty much the same thing in German. But you can never quite get us to say exactly the same thing. So for those of you for whom I'm speaking too quickly, she'll say it again in German. So my name is Pamela Klassen. I'm a professor in the Department for the Study of Religion at the University of Toronto. And together with Monique Scheer of the University of Tübingen, I direct the Religion and Public Memory Project, which has been generously supported by the Annalisa Meyer Research Award from the Humboldt Foundation, for which we're very grateful. We're also very grateful to the Jewish Museum Berlin for welcoming our idea and generously opening their doors to this public panel on museums, religion, and the work of reconciliation and remembrance. We also wanted to thank the Fritz Thyssen Foundation, which is also supporting the workshop that is going on tomorrow and the next day. So as Inka has already said, we've gathered here from very near and from very far, and I would guess that our keynote speaker, Jisgang Nika Collison, probably flew the farthest of anyone. She had the longest journey to make, all the way from what is one of the most beautiful places in the world, as you will see, Haida Gwaii, in the Pacific Northwest. And so I would particularly like to thank her for making the long journey. Nika Collison is the curator of the Haida Museum, the Museum, which is a Haida-run institution, and I highly recommend that all of you go to visit it. It is a remarkable place. We're also very grateful to, there she is, Léontine Meijer-van Mensch, who welcomed our idea for this conference early on and is going to reflect later this evening on her experiences in many museum worlds. So the juxtaposition of curatorial perspectives on Indigenous museums and Jewish museums, we think, is probably not a very common juxtaposition, so we are very excited about the conversation that is to come. Museums are houses of objects and stories, and these objects speak to us across time, but they do not say the same things to everybody. They're meant to remind us of a past, but they don't remind us all of the same past or all of the same historical narrative. So which stories and whose stories are connected to which objects becomes a contested terrain. Conversations and debates about repatriation, as I'm sure many of you are aware of, about museums returning objects acquired through unethical means to their rightful owners, communities, and lands, these conversations about repatriation highlight this complexity. The research of Robin Gray, who I think maybe is here, yes, who I have yet to meet, she's with us tonight. She shows that even songs collected by ethnographers require repatriation to Indigenous communities and nations. It's fascinating research. So we can never think of objects as speaking in one voice or to one audience. And that's where the work of storytelling or curation comes in. Museum curators and museum visitors can tell any number of stories about the objects that they meet in a museum. So we've all come here tonight, I'm going to guess, because we care to think about museums as houses of objects and stories, and as places that not only help us to remember the past, but also to live in the present and to imagine the future. And we strive to do this work of public memory better by doing it collectively, by doing it together with each other. And this is what we mean by the work of reconciliation and remembrance. So what duties and responsibilities do museums as privileged spaces of memory have for bringing people together across histories of conflict and violence through reflection and engagement with stories and with objects? Many curators and scholars are already deeply engaged in this work, and we're grateful that many of you are here for our workshop beginning tomorrow. Many of you in the audience will be very familiar with the current debates about repatriation of museum objects and new buildings for objects that perhaps require repatriation. But you may be less familiar about how religion or spirituality fits into this conversation and what we mean by actively bringing those concepts in. So I want to give a specific example. I teach a course called Museums and Material Religion, and I've taught it in Germany and I've taught it in Toronto. And the museums, different kinds of museums, become the classroom for this course. I take the students to museums. And curators and objects both help me be teachers in the context of this course. Regardless of which museum I bring students to, whether it's the Royal Ontario Museum in Toronto or an Ice Age museum in Blaubeuren in southern Germany. Has anyone been to that one? You should go. It's very interesting. Yes. Curators tell stories about what happens to the, they tell stories to the students about what happens when visitors turn the museum into a place of worship or of veneration or of ceremony. So for example, the ethnographic collections at the Royal Ontario Museum, the curators there installed a room with proper ventilation that could allow Indigenous elders to burn sweetgrass in order to do a smudge, to spiritually care for the objects in the storage room, cedar, many, many cedar boxes, pipes, beaded bags. These objects that are long stacked away in row upon row of storage shelves, they need spiritual care. In the case of Blaubeuren in the Ice Age Museum, the curator told us a story of a group of women who came to gather around the Venus of Holofels, a little mammoth carved statue carved more than 40,000 years ago and now displayed in this red room that makes you think you're in a womb, which we all were at one point, and women gather around this statue in order to perform a ritual of respect for this statue, which they think is a representation of the mother goddess. So these are ceremonial gestures that make museum spaces into shared public spaces in new and overtly religious or spiritual ways. But museums are also spaces of gathering and ceremony in ways less obviously religious, especially where concepts such as community and nation are materially and ritually presented. But again, not everyone can hear those stories if they don't know what's going on. Another way that religion enters the museum is through objects themselves. So many North American and European museums hold spiritually charged objects of contested provenance. Where did a particular mask come from? How did it get to the museum? Does it rightfully belong there? Who should be allowed to look at it? Who should be allowed to touch it? As such, the concept of religion or spirituality might also help us in our reflection on the ongoing power of objects, even when they have been extracted from their communities and from the spiritual powers that they performed in those communities. So again, increasing efforts at community reclamation of objects that call to people have brought ceremony and spirituality into museums in powerful ways. So when an indigenous person visits a storage room of a museum and burns sweetgrass around a beaded bag or a sacred pipe, they are ritually caring for that object and the relationships between people and the spirits that it represents. So considering an object in its specificity, who made it, who gave, sold, or stole it to bring it to the museum, how the museum has told its story, is a powerful path to crafting shared histories that acknowledge injustice and work towards reconciliation. As many people have pointed out, however, reconciliation is itself a Christian concept and ritual, or it's a concept with a Christian history of sorts, which means that it's not really fully adequate for the work of remembrance and restitution in museums. But the work of reconciliation and remembrance must begin with truth-telling, including how Christianity in particular has shaped the making of museum collections throughout North America and Europe. So for example, missionaries were prominent collectors for museums, gathering objects in ways that often did grave harm to the people and the spirits connected to these objects in the guise of preserving them, the objects. So these are only some of the ways that concepts of religion and spirituality profoundly shape the work of curation and the duties and responsibilities of the museum. As the researchers and the curators gathered here have shown, conversations about the repatriation of museum objects offer us all a gift, I would say. And that gift is the chance to listen to each other in new ways, to rethink our own duties and responsibilities, and to know that objects in their materiality carry with them stories, both spiritual and political, from which we all have so much to learn. So thank you very much for joining us tonight. Thank you.
Guten Abend, auch von meiner Seite herzlich willkommen. Ich heiße Monique Scheer, ich bin Professorin für empirische Kulturwissenschaft an der Universität Tübingen und zusammen mit Pamela Klassen, Professorin für Religionswissenschaft an der Universität Toronto, leiten wir gemeinsam das Projekt Religion and Public Memory, das aus den Mitteln des Anneliese-Meyer-Forschungspreises finanziert wird, die Professor Klassen 2015 von der Alexander von Humboldt-Stiftung verliehen wurde. Unser Dank gilt also, wie gesagt, der Humboldt-Stiftung, aber auch der Fritz-Thyssen-Stiftung für die großzügige Unterstützung dieses Abends und unseres Workshops. Und schließlich sind wir in höchstem Maße dem Jüdischen Museum Berlin und dieser Akademie zu Dank verpflichtet dafür, dass sie uns ihre Räume zur Verfügung stellen und ihr großartiges Team die Organisation vor Ort übernommen hat. Ohne sie wäre dieser Abend, an dem wir über Museen, Religion, Erinnerung und Versöhnung hätte nicht stattgefunden. Also vielen Dank. Dieser Begriff Reconciliation habe ich jetzt mal mit Versöhnung übersetzt. Das ist vielleicht der Anfang einer Diskussion darüber, wie wir das genau verstehen. Einige von uns sind von ziemlich weit her angereist, am weitesten, wie gesagt, vermutlich unsere Keynote-Vortragende Jisgang Nika Collison, die von einer der schönsten Orten auf Erden nach Berlin angereist ist, Haida Gwaii an der pazifischen Nordwestküste. Wir möchten uns deshalb ganz besonders bei ihr bedanken, dass sie sich für diese, dass sie für die lange Reise diese Zeit und Mühe auf sich genommen hat. Wie wir gleich hören werden, ist Frau Collison die Direktorin des Haida Gwaii Museums, ein Museum indigener Haida-Kultur, die von Haida selbst geführt wird. Ein wunderschönes Museum, das unbedingt eine Reise wert ist. Wir sind aber auch sehr dankbar, dass Léontine Meijer-van Mensch heute Abend zu uns spricht. Sie hat die Idee für diese Veranstaltung von Anfang an begrüßt und unterstützt, als sie noch hier am Museum gearbeitet hat. Eine Zeit, über die sie vielleicht heute dem Titel des Vortrags nachzuurteilen, auch vielleicht sprechen wird. Die Gegenüberstellung dieser beiden kuratorischen Perspektiven, also eines indigenen und eines jüdischen Museums, ist nicht etwas, was man alle Tage zu hören bekommt, haben wir uns gedacht. Und deswegen freuen wir uns sehr darüber und darauf. Worum es jetzt geht bei dieser Veranstaltung. Museen sind Häuser für Objekte und Geschichten. Diese Objekte sprechen zu uns quer durch die Zeit, aber sie sagen nicht allen Menschen dasselbe. Die sollen uns an eine Vergangenheit erinnern, aber sie erinnern uns nicht an die gleiche Vergangenheit, das gleiche historische Narrativ. Welche Geschichten mit welchen Objekten verbunden sind, ist immer umstritten. Diskussionen und Debatten über die Repatriierung, über die Restituierung von Objekten, die auf unethische Weise akquiriert wurden, diese Debatten werfen ein grelles Licht auf die komplexe Beziehung von Objekt und Narrativ. Wir können niemals annehmen, dass Objekte mit einer einzigen Stimme oder zu einem einzigen Publikum sprechen. Und deshalb ist das Erzählen und das Kuratieren im Museum so wichtig. KuratorInnen und BesucherInnen können eine ganze Reihe von Geschichten über die Objekte erzählen, die sie im Museum antreffen. Wir sind, nehmen wir an, heute da, weil wir darüber nachdenken möchten, wie Museen als Häuser für Objekte und Geschichten uns nicht nur helfen, die Vergangenheit zu erinnern, sondern auch in der Gegenwart zu leben und eine Zukunft zu imaginieren. Wir können das besser, wenn wir es gemeinsam tun, im Austausch miteinander. Und deshalb überschreiben wir diese Veranstaltung mit den Begriffen Erinnerung und Versöhnung, weil diese Operationen miteinander interagieren. Welche Pflichten und Verantwortung tragen Museen als privilegierte Orte der Erinnerung, Menschen über historische Narrative des Konflikts und der Gewalt zusammenzubringen durch Reflexion und der Auseinandersetzung mit den Geschichten und Objekten? Viele KuratorInnen und WissenschaftlerInnen sind bereits seit langem mit dieser Arbeit intensiv beschäftigt. Und wir sind sehr froh, dass einige von Ihnen hier sind und bei unserer Tagung dabei sein werden. Viele von Ihnen werden die derzeitigen Debatten über Repatriierung von Museumsobjekten schon sehr gut kennen, aber vielleicht sind Sie sich nicht ganz so sicher, was Religion mit diesen Debatten zu tun haben soll und was wir damit vorhaben, dass wir diesen Begriff in diese Diskussion einspeisen wollen. Ein konkretes Beispiel hat Pamela gerade erläutert. Im Rahmen eines Seminars, das sie in Toronto und Tübingen angeboten hat, geht sie mit Studierenden in Museen. Museen werden dadurch zu Seminarräumen. KuratorInnen und Museumsobjekte werden zu Lehrenden. Egal in welchem Museum sie sind, ob in Toronto, im Royal Ontario Museum oder in Blaubeuren, im Urgeschichtlichen Museum mit der Eiszeitkunst, da erzählen KuratorInnen Geschichten darüber, wie BesucherInnen den Ausstellungsraum in einen sakralen Ort verwandeln, ein Ort für Gebet, für Verehrung, für zeremonielle oder rituelle Handlungen. Am Royal Ontario Museum hat man extra einen Raum mit einer besonderen Umluftanlage zur Verfügung gestellt, damit indigene Ältere ihre heiligen Kräuter anbrennen können, um mit diesem entstehenden Rauch Objekte zu weihen. Sie kümmern sich sozusagen in spiritueller Hinsicht um die Objekte, die Kästen aus Zedernholz, die Pfeifen, die bestickten oder beperlten Taschen, die in langen Reihen im Depot des Museums lagern. Im Blaubeuren wiederum hat man sich daran gewöhnt, dass manche Besuche von Frauengruppen darin gipfeln, dass sie sich um die sogenannte Venus von Hohlefels versammeln, um ein Ritual der Anerkennung vor dieser heiligen Mutterfigur, vor der Göttin, die vor 40.000 Jahren aus Mammut-Elfenbein geschnitzt wurde, zu vollziehen. Solche zeremoniellen Gesten machen aus öffentlichen Museumsräumen neue, religiös oder spirituell aufgeladene Räume. Das ist eine Möglichkeit, wie Religion ins Museum kommt. Sie sind aber auch Räume für Zusammenkünfte und Zeremonien, die vielleicht erst auf dem zweiten Blick als religiös oder spirituell betrachtet werden können, weil Objekte als Medien für andere, Luckmann hätte gesagt, mittlere Transzendenzen wie eine Gemeinschaft oder eine Nation präsentieren. Museen bieten Räume für das Teilen von Geschichten, was aber nicht heißt, dass dieses Teilen immer auch Konsens oder Übereinstimmung bedeutet. Religion ist im Museum auch durch die Objekte selbst sehr präsent. In vielen Museen, sowohl hier in Europa als auch in Nordamerika, lagern spirituell aufgeladene Objekte mit umstrittener Provenienz. Wo kam zum Beispiel eine bestimmte Maske her? Wie kam sie ins Museum? Gehört sie rechtmäßig dorthin? Wer soll sie anschauen oder gar berühren dürfen? Und deshalb denken wir, dass dieser Begriff Religion uns auch helfen kann, über die anhaltende Macht der Dinge zu reflektieren, auch nachdem sie aus ihrem ursprünglichen Kontext entfernt worden sind und von den unmittelbar spirituellen Kräften, die sie in diesem Kontext hatten. Die Bemühungen der Gesellschaften, denen sie genommen wurden, um sich um sie zu kümmern, wo sie jetzt sind, sie wieder zu bekommen, haben diese Objekte wieder sehr stark mit Spiritualität und Zeremonie aufgeladen. Auf diese Weise hält Religion auch Einzug ins Museum. Wenn in einem Depotraum, das Beispiel nochmal, Weihrauch verbreitet wird, um sich um Objekte und den Beziehungen zwischen Menschen und jenseitigen Akteuren, die diese Objekte repräsentieren, zu pflegen, hat Religion etwas mit der Frage von Restituierung und Erinnerung zu tun. Wenn man ein Objekt in seiner ganzen Spezifizität anschaut, wer hat es geschaffen, wer hat es verschenkt oder verkauft oder geklaut, damit es ins Museum kommt, wie hat das Museum diese Geschichte erzählt? Wenn man das anschaut, dann ist das ein sehr wirkungsvoller Weg hin zu geteilten Geschichten, die Unrecht anerkennt und Versöhnung anstrebt. Der Begriff Versöhnung, Reconciliation, darauf haben KritikerInnen hingewiesen, ist vielleicht ein allzu sehr christliches Konzept, weshalb es für die Arbeit der Erinnerung und Restitution im Museum vielleicht nicht wirklich adäquat ist. Aber wie auch immer man das nennt, diese Arbeit muss beginnen mit dem Erzählen, mit Truth-Telling, Erzählen der Wahrheit darüber, wie zum Beispiel auch das Christentum, insbesondere die Sammlungen von Museen in Nordamerika und Europa geprägt hat. Das ist ein anderer Aspekt von Religion in diesem Kontext. Missionare und Missionarinnen waren ganz zentrale Agenten und SammlerInnen von Objekten, die in Museen gekommen sind. Und sie haben sie häufig in einer Weise gesammelt, die die spirituellen Beziehungen, die solche Objekte materiell verkörpern, vermitteln, massiv gestört haben. So, das waren jetzt nur ein paar Hinweise darauf, wie Religion und Spiritualität die Arbeit in Museen und deren Verantwortung gegenüber den Objekten prägen. Die WissenschaftlerInnen und KuratorInnen, die für unsere Tagung hier zusammengekommen sind, haben in ihren Arbeiten gezeigt, dass die derzeitigen Debatten über die Restitution von Museumsobjekten eigentlich, wie Pamela sagte, ein Geschenk sind. Sie schaffen damit die Möglichkeit, dass wir einander zuhören auf eine neue Weise, über unsere Pflicht und Verantwortung nachdenken und aufs Neue realisieren, dass Objekte Geschichten in sich tragen, sowohl spirituelle als auch politische, von denen wir noch sehr viel lernen können. So, and now I would like to pass the microphone to our co-convener tonight, Sharon Macdonald, who will moderate the rest of the evening. Sharon is an Alexander von Humboldt professor for social anthropology at the Humboldt Museum, Humboldt University, sorry, in Berlin. So much. the Humboldt University, where she directs the Center for Anthropological Research on Museums and Heritage, which houses a large number of fascinating research projects that I can't all name on current transformations of museums and understandings of heritage. And one of the most prominent, as one of the most prominent anthropologists working on the way that museums and heritage professionals work and their institutions, she is the author of Difficult Heritage, Negotiating the Nazi Past in Nuremberg and Beyond from 2009, and the author of Memory Lands, Heritage and Identity in Europe Today, 2013, as well as a long list of further publications on museum studies, which you have to visit her website to get to fully see. No wonder that aside from Berlin, she has also been asked to teach at the University of York in the UK and at the University of Beijing in China. We are very happy to have her here today to chair this panel. Sharon, the floor is yours.
Good evening, everybody. Really great to see, to see lots of people I know here. But to begin with, thank you so much for that lovely introduction. For me, when Pamela and Monique came and said they had this idea for this conference, I was very happy to say, yeah, we would very much like to work with you on it, not just because I knew they're such great people, but because I think it is really, really wonderful theme here. And it also absolutely touches on lots of the issues that we're interested in this research center that I set up in Berlin, so the Center for Anthropological Research on Museums and Heritage. And as I say it, I realize that its name, CARMAH, I hadn't massively kind of thought about that as a religious term, but there we are. But especially in our major research project, which itself is funded by the Alexander von Humboldt Foundation, a project called Making Differences, Transforming Museums and Heritage in the 21st Century. In that project, we have various themes, but one of the issues there that we do look at, because we have a central focus on museums, the ways in which museums and heritage are in transformation, and the way in which they can, in various ways, prompt forms of social and cultural transformation. We focus in that partly on transformations here in Berlin. So it's very nice to be here at the Jewish Museum, and I thank colleagues here at the Jewish Museum in Berlin for hosting this as well. But we also want to look and come into conversation with other places and other ideas and so on. So I especially really welcome this this event this evening and also the workshop that follows. And I'd like to add my thanks to those who've traveled far and also near. One of the reasons that religion has some presence in our own research project is that it clearly is a source for a good deal of division in contemporary society. So that is one of the reasons, though not only, but also those questions about what counts as sacred and about various forms of remembering. So in the conference that follows this, you can actually hear from the workshop that follows this, you can hear from some of our researchers who are doing their own research. I know you can't all be there at that, so then I can just suggest that you have a look at our CARMAH website, and it's spelt with a C rather than the K, and you'll see their work there, and I'm sure that they would be happy to come into conversation with you if you like. So museums have sometimes played very negative roles in the images that they've provided of people and in the acts of appropriation of material culture, of immaterial culture, and also of former people in what are usually referred to as human remains. And the reverberations of that continue. So the question about what museums themselves can do in relation to remembrance, reconciliation, and maybe something else that we haven't yet quite found the right word for, and I was really taken by the comment by Pamela and Monique, of what is the word we want in this context. So that question is, I think, absolutely vitally important. And my own view is not only do they have a duty to play such a role, but actually they have massive untapped capacity to do so. And they do so partly because of those very roles that they've played in the past, but partly because of their collections and what they hold and their roles as institutions of memory. Well, my main role, or my only role really, is to introduce this evening, and so I'd better get on with it because this is the bit you really want, to introduce two tremendous speakers, so Jisgang Nika Collison and Léontine Meijer-van Mensch, who've not only reflected on these matters, but they've really been involved with putting them into practice in very various ways through their own direct engagement and their gifting, and I think it is a gift of energy and talent. And to me, that the museum world is now seeing such fantastic, committed, and imaginative women taking up the helms is surely one of the best signs of all for the future of museums. Let me just then, at that point, tell you about the format that we're going to have. So we're going to have the two speakers, one after another, and then open up for more discussion. So you've got to hold on to your questions for that, for after you've heard from both. And I'm going to, at this point, just introduce Nika, and then I'll introduce Léontine in between. So, Jisgang Nika Collison is executive director and curator of the Haida Gwaii Museum, as we've already heard, and that's based in Kai Ulungai in British Columbia. Its name meaning sea lion town, I was very pleased to learn. And that museum was established in 1976, and it has, and sadly I haven't visited it, but now I know I have to, and if I looked at its website, I'd immediately have known I had to. But it's built up this considerable reputation for showcasing Haida historical and contemporary art, for its collections of material culture and its archives, as well as for its public engagement. Nika has worked as co-chair of the Haida Repatriation Project, and she's also edited books on Haida culture and law. And so your work, as I understand it, it really has been very long-standing working with and as part of the Haida community in a thoroughly engaged way, and including working with traditional practices such as dance. You yourself are from, as I understand, you can come and correct all this in a minute, I got it wrong. You yourself are from the Tsai Eagle clan, and as well as directing the museum, your work in the museum, you're a singer, a drummer, and I'm especially pleased to learn a weaver. So at that moment, I'd like to turn over to you as our first keynote. Thank you very much.
Pega, where is my paper? That's what. That's okay. I could. I need my backpack, and I could read it from my computer, actually. So it's in the room. Could you grab it? Okay. Okay. Well, I guess I could begin. I'm a little nervous, but anyways. Kuljat ganga, kilslai ganga, khairagat la sis, dalang wadluhan gato kiltla, jisgang khanudi ki gaga, di kayas lanas, gathlai khanu di lana auga. Pamela Manique, Jewish Museum, Leantina, Hawa Saudang Haida, Ahayat It Skangulchaga, It Kunisi, Dalangwa Luchan Dikugaga, It Kunisi Diyakudanga, It Kunisi Hawa. At the lung sting, the lung wadluhan scoudigi gathu kentla. Highborn women, highborn men, good people, thank you all for being here today. My name is Jisgang Nika Collison, Yatshairaga Kithki. My English name is Nika Collison. I'm from the Kayathlanis clan. My chief is Gothlai. He is our town mother. What else did I say? I feel really good today. I thank Pamela and Monique and the Jewish Museum for bringing us together, and for Leontine, my new friend, well, all of you. So that we can be here working together. I thank our ancestors. I love our ancestors. I respect our ancestors. And again, thank you all for being here. I can speak well of you. Just have to find it. I get a little bit more than 30 minutes, right? Okay. There it is. Okay, and I'm not sure. Oh, it's there. Okay, and then do I just use one of these clickers? Yeah, all right. Oh, don't move. Okay. All right. Being both Haida and executive director, curator of the Haida Gwaii Museum, I've enjoyed unique opportunities that stem from making my life and my life my work. I'm privileged to work alongside my nation to uphold Haida law, Haida ways of knowing and being, and to work in this manner with global museums. One of the main laws of the Haida Nation is Yahkudangang, respect. Meaning respect for all things, land, water, air, the supernatural, our ancestors, and each other. As my auntie Gwaganat taught me, it is only when we show such respect that we can be worthy of respect ourselves. As museum professionals and as human beings, we carry the responsibility to affect society by mainstreaming Canada's dark history with Indigenous peoples, while actively working to set things right. In the Haida Museum world, the path towards conciliation has been shaped by Yahkudangang, the act of paying respect. The Haida Nation sees this work, which includes repatriation, as based upon mutual respect, cooperation, and trust. Yahkudangang is how the remains of our ancestors have been brought home. It is how our own museum was born and is what our collection of treasures is built upon. Yahkudangang has brought a new depth to the Haida Nation's healing and our ability to heal with others. It affords opportunity for Western museums to become voluntary agents of change rather than the physical evidence of Canada's genocide against First Peoples. Our ancestors surround us. We are here knowing who we are and where we come from because of them. For decades, our nation and museum have worked to bring home over 500 of our ancestors from museums and private homes around the world with honor and respect. It's cost well well over $1 million in cash, sweat labor, and donations to do this work. The majority of these costs have been borne by our nation. How we found ourselves in this position, why we do this work, and where it is taking us all is a story that should be known and never forgotten. Historically, every Haida clan had a professional storyteller that kept our extensive histories intact, word for word. From this, we know histories that predate human occupation on Earth, that in the beginning, it was both light and dark, and the world was covered with water. Only the supernaturals floated there, tired and in need of land. We know of the creation of Haida Gwaii and the mainland, the releasing of the stars and the moon, the bringing of salmon and fresh water to our islands, all of this and much more, safe kept by the storytellers. I am taught by my Auntie Gwaganot, who learned from oral historian Nunkingite Yuan's James Young, that we first came out of the air but did not survive. We did not survive when we came out of the earth. We as Haida today, we come from the ocean. The supernaturals took pity on us, and that is why we are here. Our histories recount times when the earth was unbearably hot, the coming of the last ice age, of rising and falling waters. These stories have aided science in understanding the past. For example, science recently discovered that the first tree to grow on Haida Gwaii after the last ice age began to recede, approximately 12 to 14,000 years ago, was the pine tree, just as our ancestors said. The first accepted documentation of European and Haida encounters occurred in 1774 when the Spanish ventured into Haida waters. The British soon followed, fulfilling the prophecy of Ascaga, a medicine man, who warned of the coming of the spirit of pestilence. Purposefully introduced epidemics with vaccines withheld brought the Haida population from upwards of 30,000 people or more down to 600. Survivors went on to face Canada's Indian Act of 1867, which put us on tiny reserves, made us wards of the state, and declared us Indians. It created, can't help the air quotes, legal mechanisms to disenfranchise us from our communities. From 1884 to 1951, the Act outlawed the potlatch, a legal system integral to the social, political, and economic systems up and down the Northwest Coast of what is called Canada. It was predominantly during this period that Haida burials were desecrated and the remains of hundreds of our ancestors were stolen, along with thousands of our belongings by various Indian agents, missionaries, anthropologists, and explorers. We know of over 12,000 pieces held in global museums that are attributed Haida. And that was an inventory that we stopped doing around 2006. Most of what wasn't stolen was handed over or sold under duress. And it is very important to repeat this. Most of what wasn't stolen was handed over or sold under duress. Our way of life was outlawed, and we faced extreme social and economic marginalization, all of this required finding our way in this new world. The Indian Act informed some of the apartheid policy in South Africa. The Indian Act is still alive today. The church also heard our people, and even more so when they formed church day schools in our villages and later joined with the Canadian government to create the residential school system in 1892. The last residential school closed in Canada in 1996. Canada tried to destroy our spirit, our identity, our language, our Haida-ness. They wanted us to forget our responsibility to Haida Gwaii, the supernatural, and each other, to forget our understanding of who we are and our place in this world. Perhaps the greatest tragedy in all of this is, as my friend Gdansta once told me, this is the story of the world. When I was recounting the real story of Canada to my then 13-year-old daughter, Git Koyas, she went quiet for a long time before she spoke of the colonizers, so generously stating, "They sure had misguided minds, hey, Mum?" Amazingly, our surviving ancestors not only survived, many thrived, and I know they worked very hard so we could be here today. They ensured our knowledge and practices were passed down, often using Western practices as a guise. What could not be passed down orally was preserved through our ancestors choosing to work with anthropologists, the ones that we actually interacted with, to record our history. Our ancestors never surrendered Haida Gwaii. Acting as conduits between past, present, and future, their refusal to let our identity die ensured we would carry on as Haidas. This was made possible through adherence to Haida laws and values, systems and beliefs, and the ability to adapt and innovate. At the same time, artists continued to create for both culture and sale, so that by the late 1800s, Haida art reached the height of its classical form. The most artists of the mid-1900s had less formal training, for the masters died off as colonial impact deepened. They continued on in the arts, nourishing their spirits, providing for their families, and leaving a legacy for future generations. Drawing on the gifts provided by both living knowledge holders and those living before us, artists began to carve out a new chapter in Haida history, creating pivotal works such as the first monumental poles to be raised using Haida law and ceremony in almost 100 years. Weavers not only kept the art of weaving alive and textiles, they kept their use alive. With this strong reintegration of art into social function, Haida art began its ascent back into our daily lives. My cousin Clayton Gladstone once said to me, "It brought the rest back out. That's how important the art is." Haida art is the visual companion to Haida kil, the Haida language. Art and language are fundamental forms of Haida communication and the vehicles for Haida history. Serving both social and economic functions, art also demonstrates the importance our nation puts on high aesthetics, and it is highly political. And I'm taken by the words of French novelist André Malraux, who is quoted as saying, "Art is a revolt, a protest against extinction." Sathlind and I, Saving Things House, also known as the Haida Gwaii Museum, is one of the earliest acts of maybe the word you're looking for, tulhyata, making things right, between Indigenous people and mainstream museums. A vision of both Haida citizens and Canadians residing on our islands, our museum opened in 1976 in Kailnagai, an ancient village dating back to the time of the supernaturals. This is where my clan came out of the ocean. Since most of our treasures were taken, our museum didn't have a collection to begin with, but several families on Haida Gwaii, both Haida and settler, donated their treasures. The Royal British Columbia Museum showed support by returning some monumental poles. I think possibly the earliest voluntary repatriation from a museum in Canada. This act was not necessitated by law or policy. It was an act of humanity. We have since grown a beautiful collection of treasures and also present new works as we are living culture. We share in our inextricable relationship with the land, sea, and supernaturals of Haida Gwaii. And we give space to ethnic cultures both on and off our islands, such as British and Euro-Canadians. In 2008, our museum grew with the creation of the Haida Heritage Center at Kailnagai. Conceptualized and driven by our people, it houses several cultural and educational spaces and organizations in addition to our museum. Throughout, every experience, word, treasure, and image has been developed by our people so that we can share what we want to share, so we can say what we want to say. Amongst it all is a flinganai, a grave house, built to house ancestral remains unearthed during construction of the center and to act as a holding place for repatriated ancestors awaiting reinterment. Museum people must understand that every time they do something with our belongings, they are messing with our lives. Our museum operates in line with Haida society. We seek direction from our elders and leaders and people on the ground on proper conduct and in the caring and sharing of our treasures. For example, we would never have raised those three poles without the permissions of the Kariska Kigawai, Kuna Kigawai, and the Sangastastis people from whom these poles descend. The Haida Gwaii Museum and the Haida Heritage Center are not institutions in and of themselves. They are part of the institution that makes up Haida society and greater society. We provide space, support, and opportunity for artistic and cultural practices, ceremonies, research, education, capacity building, repatriation, and so on. We are driven by the community and are part of and contribute to our Haida way of life, both inside and outside of our house. And I want you to know that in our house, I often counsel young interns as they cry, because like me, they didn't learn the real history in school. They learned it deeply through working at our museum. But because they feel safe there, they can arm themselves with their tears using their grief to make positive change in the world. Working with mainstream museums to repair some of our shared history has brought two worlds together and is in fact creating a new one. This work has taken decades and will continue to do so. While not a lifeway known to our ancestors, today it is part of Haida culture, a dedication to our ancestors, to our children, to our future, to Haida Gwaii. When we're at museums, we visit our belongings and our other containers of knowledge, such as archives. We bring the diaspora of our people's lives home through imagery, audio recordings, collection notes, and the recreation of ancestral pieces, and through the physical, emotional, and spiritual connections that forever bind us. Most of the collection at our museum has been acquired through donations, private repatriations, commissions, and long-term loans. With our work with our ancestors near completion, we are now seeking the return of our material, some of the return of our material and intangible heritage from museums. This is a photo of hereditary leader Gdansta at his inauguration potlatch in 2017. On his left is a new chest recreated by Gdansta's sons, Jalin and Gwai Edenshaw, from an ancient chest held at the Pitt Rivers Museum, a project made possible by Laura Pierce. On his right is an ancient chest that is held in the American Museum of Natural History in New York. Our museum brokered a loan so the chest could participate in this historic potlatch. It was then exhibited for a year in our museum and is currently being recreated by Gujau's or Gdansta's sons. This new chest will be safe kept in our museum for future use in our community. This ancient chest spans back seven generations of chiefs in Gdansta's lineage, the Gagyals Kigawai. I want to be clear that recreations of our belongings are a powerful form of repatriating knowledge, a practice that spans back to about the 1950s, but like the important work of digitization, should never be considered a replacement for returning some of our belongings. Ooh, how do I do this? I need to play it. Probably this one, hey? Yakudangang has been significant in the revival of our language, art, and culture, and in healing ourselves. See, I get a little bit more than 30 minutes for this. How would I play this? It's a video. Okay. It's too bad because this is a film actually showing Gdansta dancing, validating his name, his responsibility. I'll just continue on. It is the most important work, Yakudangang, that I've ever been involved in. The healing is not only ours. When we work closely together with museums, the playing field is leveled. Museum staff begin to understand us on our terms, not just their terms. They appreciate that nation-based scholarship is on par with Western-based scholars. Many of us have developed dear friendships with museum staff, such as Laura Pierce, Kara Krumpotich, my new friend Reiner, all here today. This work has also resulted in a new gathering place for Indigenous peoples. We reconnect with old friends and make new ones, which are now old friends, but such as Alan Corby and Robin Gray, who are also both here tonight. Yakudangang is changing Haida history and Canada's history, and it has changed the ways some mainstream museum staff see themselves, their own settler histories, and their museum's histories. It helps them address or heal from the shame of colonialism. The bigger shame, then, becomes not working towards Yakudangang. However, the worst shame... Whoa! Now, but it's sideways. I don't want to do this. That's not right. I can't show it that way. However, I want to back up. The bigger shame then becomes not working towards Yakudangang. The worst shame is the commodification of the word reconciliation, the commodification. At the same time that the Canadian government claims to support Indigenous peoples and embrace reconciliation, they continue to relentlessly push unsustainable and dangerous industries such as dirty oil and gas through our unceded territories. Industries that have the capacity to destroy that which makes us Haida. In 2015, Canada's Truth and Reconciliation Commission came out with a list of calls to action. In 2016, Canada signed on to UNDRIP almost 10 years later from when it was adopted. Do not let the work of these documents have been created in vain. That is what scares me, the ephemeral nature of these beautifully crafted, powerful truths. Their words are still chained to paper. This we know. Hundreds of thousands of Indigenous people dead from epidemics. Thousands upon thousands more dead or scarred from residential school. My friend's mom sent away at 4 years old. My relative, who cannot be part of our family or any family because they don't know how to. Elders who could not speak of their time at school and refused to speak Haida for a lot of their lives because they were beaten for doing so in residential school. My great-great-grandmother, who never moved back home, who did everything she could to be mistaken for a Victorian lady, who scorned one of her sons because he looked too Indian. my father, my grandparents, my aunties, uncles, and cousins, my dear friend just 5 years older than me who wanted to die. He just wanted to die. The full spectrum of abuses I myself have navigated as a multi-generation survivor. As Shelley Joseph says, our brave children, such brave children, beaten, starved, experimented on, such brave children, taken to be adopted out over and over again, still today. Such brave children, many who live without clean drinking water and adequate housing, today, in Canada. I want to be clear, I have a lot of great Canadian friends. We're talking about government. You can tell how one nation views another, not only by how they treat their living, but also by how they treat their dead. Indigenous ancestors stolen, children's graves hidden, the continued degradation of Indigenous burial grounds. It didn't stop a few decades ago. It hasn't stopped. It just lives in a different form. Our missing and murdered Indigenous women, our brave women, our brave girls. Reconciliation begins at home. It begins with decolonization in your head, heart, and spirit. It involves pursuing knowledge, pursuing the truth, and affording acceptance. For dominant societies, this means coming with genuine empathy and intent, without prejudice, defensiveness, or impatience. No UNDRIP and the TRC calls for action. No our shared history and the real history of Canada. Find your grief, no ours. Don't wait for a prescription that may or may not come. Change the way you exist in the world. Pay respect to our brave ancestors, our brave children, our brave women and men. Promise yourself you will dedicate time to ensuring my daughters will be considered equal to any other human being, that they are not seen as inconvenient when protecting the earth and then otherwise romanticized. Don't wait for your law or policies. Through Yahkudangang, mountains have been moved. Don't say you don't know how. Say you will figure it out. That is how our museum works. That is how our nation works. That is why I believe we are all here today. Reconciliation cannot happen without decolonization, which cannot really happen without people giving themselves back to the earth and the supernatural. Once reconnected with what gives life and spirit, people will have a lot more to give than to take. When my now 10-year-old daughter, 11-year-old daughter, turned 6, I asked her what the most important thing in the world was. Jewel said water. I asked her what the second most important thing in the world was, and she said love. My children give me hope. That we are all here together gives me hope. I am here to learn and share, and I'm here to invite you to enter into a war with us, which some of you already have. A war necessitated by our shared history. A war we will fight together, side by side. A war against the relentlessness of the colonial mindset. By nature, museums reflect the social climate they exist within. Responsible museums bring attention to historic and current paradigms, all the while looking to the future. Effective museums not only have people paying attention, they inspire them to engage in pursuing and enacting healthy public and political discourse. Please join us in this war, one that can only be done through mutual respect, cooperation, and trust, through kindness and truth-telling and understanding, through decolonizing our minds. Be brave with us, as our ancestors were, as our dear children were, as our dear children are, please enter this brave war with us, a beautiful war. At the Lungsting, the Lungwa, Luhanska, Rigi, Gathul, Kiltlan.
Thank you so much, Jisgang Nika Collison. Extraordinarily moving, and you also, I think, give us direction. So thank you very, very much. Let me turn now to introduce Léontine Meijer-van Mensch, who many here will know because of her time as program director here at the Jewish Museum in Berlin, where we are now. And that followed a period of being deputy director at the Museum of European Cultures until 2017. And actually during that time, she was part of the curatorial team working on the Berlin exhibition for the Humboldt Forum. And actually that was partly where I came to know her very well, as I was doing anthropological fieldwork with that team. And I felt like I learned the most tremendous amount from Léontine, especially, but not only about participation, but about thinking really imaginatively about things, and really having chance to witness her absolutely superlative people skills, as well as an extraordinary and sometimes rather wicked sense of humor. Léontine is very well known as a museologist who's worked for a long time in the Netherlands, including at the Jewish Historical Museum there, and also at the Rijnvaart Academy. She's had important roles in ICOM, including on its international board, and was a founding member of COLCOM, which is the Contemporary Collections Committee. From earlier this year, though, she took up the it's a sort of multiple posts. I don't quite know how you say it, but as director of the Ethnographic Collections in Dresden and Leipzig. And I think having somebody with these this crossing of worlds in these ways puts her in a very special position for a particular kind of insight that she's going to share with us this evening. So over to you, Léontine.
It's beautiful, but also a bit strange to stand here back at my old spot and not really detoxed yet, I must admit. But it's nice to be in a panel with only women and young women. That's all. Younger women, so that's good. That feels very good. I will talk not out of paper because I'm the only non-native speaker. I will speak openly. And not read out loud. I would like to talk today tonight about the Jewish in the ethnographic and how they are linked and tied together, apart from, of course, very strong discourse on repatriation and looted art, and how, especially on a methodological level, the ethnographic discourse can learn a lot from what is being going on in the Jewish context, in that context, already for a longer period of time. And I think there's also a lot to be said about the sexiness of the Jewish Museum when that was opened almost 20 years ago. I mean, there was hardly a day when there was nothing written about the museum before it was opened. And most of the time that was very negative. So it was difficult at that time, but also a bit daring to be part of that curatorial team that curated the first exhibition. And I feel sort of the same way when I now read everything which is connected to the Humboldt Forum. You know, everybody in the Humboldt Forum, everything that they're doing is wrong according to press. I connect there. because I felt the same 20 years ago, I must say. And therefore, for me, it was also interesting to going back to the Jewish museum context a few years ago, because I felt ethnology in the post-colonial is in and the Jewish thing in Germany is sort of out. And not being in anymore, you can also, you know, try to think out of the box, to experiment more, to be more daring. And now being back in the ethnographical context, but not in Berlin, but in Saxony, gives me the feeling of that I maybe can be such a space where you can experiment a bit more, because not all the whole public eye is focused on what I'm doing, and that's quite a relief, I must say. Tonight, I will speak out of the context of the reflective practitioner. I was also being framed as a curator, so I will not speak so much out of a managerial perspective, but more of a curatorial perspective, out of a curatorial perspective. And I hope I won't be too descriptive. But I think that museum theory and discourse can benefit a lot from looking at case studies, and also looking and thinking with people that reflect on their everyday practice. Because I sometimes feel that museum and heritage discourse is so away from everyday museum practice, and I always try to sort of bridge that gap. And both museums, of course, also, or both museum types, the ethnological and the Jewish, they're very much into contextualization. I think that's also something that we have in common. I won't talk so much about the indigenous museum, but more the ethnographical museum, which is part of that, but also completely different. I will talk about concepts and words like representation. What does that mean in those two contexts? What does meaning-making mean? And who owns this meaning-making? And how can we open up the discourse on meaning-making? So who owns the narrative? So it's all about control, isn't it? Or letting go, on the other hand. Who is involved? Who is the owner? The ownership of collections? Or can we and should we not talk more about this concept of guardianship? And how transparent can we and should we be as museums? And of course, both also connect this very difficult concept of identities. I find it a difficult concept, but I don't really have a better one at this moment when I talk about those two museums. And of course, stakeholders. Stakeholders is something that hardly is being reflected upon in museum theory, and it's so enormously important in your everyday museum practice. And I can tell you a lot about that. I would like to start with sort of deconstructing the modernist museum. And luckily, Fiona Cameron has done that for me. And I won't read the whole slide because that's boring. And you can read it yourself. And I think we've been trying to get away from this modernist museum concept already from the 70s onwards, this concept of new museology, community museums, and the founding of your museum, I would frame as a sort of, you know, anti-modernist museum standard or statement. But we're still there. We're also still there, I think, in this modernist museum frame or if we want it or not, because we are still talking a lot about hierarchies and solid, fixed identities. And the political still plays a very important role. And the Modernist Museum still talks about the desire to represent. I think we're still very much in that context, although we are more and more talking about multi-perspectivity, but how do we do that in practice? So this Modernist Museum is something that I always try to sort of deconstruct, but it's difficult to deconstruct something when you're also working in such a context. And not only because you're working in such a context, but also because not only a lot of your fellow colleagues are still thinking about the museum in such a way, but it's also the audience and your stakeholders that reflect on what a museum should be like in such a way quite often. And of course, a lot has happened since the 70s, and I think when we're talking about communities, it's interesting to open up this concept of communities. And there, for me, Zygmunt Bauman was very important. That Zygmunt Bauman wrote interesting, interesting words about these fixed identities opening up, and therefore that we also might need to look at identities and communities in a more broader and heterogeneous way. So what Fiona Cameron has done, she is taking this concept of liquid modernity, she's taking the Baumannischen concept to put it as a contra-narrative, to take another stand than this modernist museum. And that is a concept that I like, that I feel very, that as a museum professional and somebody who likes to reflect on museums, that I can strongly relate to, and I hope you can relate to it yourself. Fiona Cameron writes about the liquid museum, that in this liquidity frame and in this concept of the liquidity, we are now all sort of, institutions are no longer or solely conceived as hierarchical, closed, or fixed to a physical location. So what does that mean if we think about such a liquid museum in your everyday museum practice? She writes about soft power. So it's a different concept as the political we just read about in the Modernist Museum. And she talks about heterogeneous practices that are light, that are more fluid and more mobile and more unpredictable, which I think that is something that we as museum people should embrace more. She writes a lot of interesting other things about the concept of the liquid museum. But she talks about what is trust, what is authority. Let us think more in the concept of networks, and let us participate more, and let us not shy away from conflict. And that is something that we as a museum should do. We should not shy away from conflict in this liquid museum context, because it's all very complex. Basically, that is what she says. Another interesting woman, as you see, I've tried to work with women today, is Janet Marstein. Janet Marstein is a museum ethic thinker, and what she writes fits for me perfectly in this concept of this liquid museum, in this more open, not hierarchical, fixed, canonized construct. And what she says is museum ethics of the 21st century should not prioritize the institution's responsibility to objects above else. So we need to think differently about our collections, about ownership. And of course, this very strongly relates to concept of repatriation, shared ownership, but the concept of ownership in itself. Are museums owner of collections, or are museums guardians of collections? And if we are guardians of collections, then maybe somebody else is an owner, a moral or ethical owner, and that we should think about that more differently. What she is also implying, or at least that's how I read Janet Marstein, is that we should, in museum context, embrace the intangible much more as we ever did before. And it was so beautiful that you earlier on mentioned your generational memory. And I know of some communities that have a generational memory of 200 or even 400 generations. So it's a way of collecting stories, a way of maintaining your cultural heritage. And this is a very beautiful example of expressing that, making that part of your programming in your museum. This is the British Museum, not known for its very innovative museum work, but at least they tried in their Sunday afternoon programming reflect on this idea of storytelling, of intangible heritage, and that that museum spaces are more than only spaces for the tangible. Of course, this thinking about more than just objects also embraces this performativity. What does performativity mean, especially in the context of the intangible heritage in a museum space? But here it's very important to ask this ethical question: who is doing what for whom? And what does authenticity mean? What does authenticity in this performativity mean in a Jewish museum context when klezmer is being danced? And is it important to know who is dancing and who are the musicians? Or if we don't think about that, should we then also reflect on those critical concepts of cultural appropriation? And in the context of the Jewish, especially in the context of the Jewish in Germany, I think, and in the context of ethnological museums, we should critically think about cultural appropriation. Who is doing what for whom is something that I'm extremely interested in, and therefore I would like to take you back to a very museological formative place for me, namely the Jewish Historical Museum in Berlin. A museum, the Jewish Historical Museum in Amsterdam. Thank you for correcting me. The Jewish Historical Museum in Amsterdam is based in the Ashkenazi Synagogical Center, at least before the war. After the war, it was abandoned, in the heart of what you could say the old former Jewish quarter. And this, and there, it has the same interesting historical tradition as the Jewish Museum in Berlin. Both museums were part of a city museum. This one, the City Museum in Amsterdam, and the one in Berlin, the City Museum West, that Inka briefly mentioned. And it was a Jewish curatorial team, it was Jewish historians, it was Jewish activists interesting enough, all second generation biographies who wanted to organize, to find this independent museum. And I see a lot of resemblance to what you have been doing, Vera Bent, in the Jewish Museum in Berlin when you were responsible for the museum. But then other stakeholders, then politics took over, and then this museum went into a different direction. But in the early days, the two museum types can very much be seen as a sort of same in the same development. So very much a bottom-down grassroots initiative, where, of course, it is very important that it is in the former Ashkenazi synagogue complex. It is also very important that at the other side of the street, there's still a Sephardic synagogue that is still giving services, where it still is a synagogue where prayer is said every day. So it is in a living context. So what does this living heritage mean for this musealized museum? It means, in this musealized context, it means that this museum is much more a community museum than the one that we are here now. It is a museum that not solely addresses Jewish visitors, otherwise the museum would not have such good visitor numbers, but it has a sort of inner Jewish speech, an inner Jewish DNA, which you can see when you enter the museum. There's somebody from the community that gives information, as, for example, you are a foreign tourist and with a Jewish religious background, and you want to know where services are being held. You can ask this person, and this person is also proactively, inviting you to maybe, if you want to know more, if you want to become part of this community, of this museum, become a friend of the museum. So it's very much a sort of Jewish space, a non-religious space, but it's a Jewish space in a way, which doesn't mean that every museum people working there has a Jewish background, but it's sort of identifying yourself with this story. So deliberately communicating with the community and being there for the community. And being there for the community in a museum context means for the Jewish museum that they deliberately work with the concept of collection mobility in the museum. Here you see a very beautiful Chanukiah, which is 18th century. It's very beautiful. Highlight of Ashkenazi Dutch culture, but once a year it's being packed by the museum people, and it's moved into the synagogue at now the other side of town, where the Chanukah festivities are being celebrated with this chandelier, and then after 9 days the chandelier is moved back within the museum context. So there is this very deliberate act of saying, okay, this is living heritage, this is spiritual object, at least it's an object that is being used in a specific context, and we are very flexible in that. We want to have this museological object also a sense of usage and meaning making in this primary Jewish context, which is hardly being done in other museums with 18th century silver chandeliers. In a Jewish museum, it's a different museum, and Inka already mentioned a lot about the coming into being of this museum. That's why I won't get into that. But of course, it is this space of memory, also this space of reconciliation in a way, in a sort of post-Shoah spiritual meaning, and maybe less for people with a Jewish background as for people with a non-Jewish background, for the German non-Jewish background, at least when the museum was open at first. So to talk about the museum as a community space, it doesn't fit, it doesn't make sense, it's not correct. But what is interesting, I think, is since the opening of the museum, the whole fabric of the Jewish life changed in the whole of Germany, but especially in Berlin, is that we need, or what I wanted as the program director, rethink the connection with the Jewish world. And here I go back to the PhD of Alina Gromova, where she interviewed young Russian or Jews in Berlin with a Russian-Soviet background, highly acculturated, non-religious, mostly group of people, but with a sense and a Jewish identity, in a sense of being Jewish. And what you see in those mental maps that she used for her PhD is that the Jewish Museum functions as a place of memory, a space of identity making, a space of meaning making. And that the museum, I think, should think about that and offer more programming, offer more participatory strategies for those people to be felt welcome. And I think if you do that, you increase the relevancy of this institution enormously. What we had at the end of last year in September was a Jewish wedding. A Jewish wedding in the Jewish Museum, which is not so enormously strange in the Jewish Museum of Amsterdam context, but quite rare in this space, because it's another space than the Amsterdam space. And we were very happy that this couple wanted to be wed in the garden. And what we did is, or what I tried to do, is work with a museum object. I must be honest, it's a prop. It's not an authentic object from our collection, but it's a prop. And I thought it's a first start to think more and more differently about collection mobility between the source community or a community and the museum collection. So this Kiddush cup was used in the ceremony, and afterwards we placed the cup in our exhibition. And of course, sharing that story, sharing that that biography of the object. I saw that I have 5 minutes left, and I still have a lot of slides. these are my two ethnology museums that I now work with. And of course, we work with repatriation. Repatriation is something that is now constantly on my everyday plate of work. And in April, we had a group of Aboriginals from a community from West Australia. And they came because we rehumanized their ancestors who were before shown as objects with an inventory number in the Zwinger till 1941. And after 1941, they were put in boxes. And the community was a week with us. And after this week, we had a ceremony in the Australian embassy and we gave those human remains back. 50 human remains were giving back to the community. So here, this idea of guardianship and giving away objects to the source community was one of my first moments in the museum. And we did that the whole week with a ceremony in the museum with all the museum workers. And I think after this week, I can say that we reconciliized with this difficult heritage of the museum and the difficult biographies of our predecessors as museum workers, which is in the DNA of the building, which is in the DNA of your everyday practice still in a way. And I find the concept of reconciliation also very difficult, and I would like to throw in a concept for our discussion that I would frame as tikkun olam. It's a very Jewish concept, and it's to repair the world. And that we, and I would then say not Jews, but we have, all of us have the obligation to repair the world. And I felt that within this act of repatriation, we as a museum tried to make a contribution into repairing of the world in this very asymmetric, colonial, but of course in this context, a very 19th century Darwinist way of framing people at that time, which is still part of my museum classification, for example. So how can you actively change those 19th century classifications of people? One last, and then I will end. Give me one last element. This is a Minkisi. This is a spiritual object or an object that hosts a spirit, an ancestor. It's not an easy object because those Minkisis can take, and I can tell you more and hours about it, but to make a long story very short, it can have a very dark meaning over time. So you have to be careful. And you also have to respect, also if they don't have this darker spirituality, you have to respect the spiritual objects or the spiritual loadedness of these objects. The community says, because my museum in Leipzig, we have 90 of those objects. We have a very large collection. And they were proudly shown. And they were also very much exoticized. You still see some YouTube films that were made with very spooky music. But maybe we can have a different way of showing them. If we take the community, which is not the source community, but at least the community that is now living at those spaces where those objects were first being collected, if we take their feelings seriously. So what they are actually saying when they came to us is like, you should not show these objects anymore. And we have a lot of those objects in our museum collection that if we respect the spirituality of these objects, then we should not show them. It's against it's against the core DNA of this object, you could say, at least in the context of meaning making. So more and more museums are thinking about dark storage rooms. Dark storage rooms where they're still being kept if we're not giving them back. I think these objects could be given back. But if we don't give them back, maybe we should have a different way of storaging them and not show them to the people anymore. That's an interesting concept if you take this spirituality and also what the source community is saying seriously. Or you go completely different ways. You ask, as my predecessor did, artists, intellectuals, museum people, in this case from Kinshasa, because these Ninkisis come from Congo, to work with the collection and to give new meaning making. It's actually the same what you've been talking about before. And then you get new Ninkisis that maybe we should show, and not these ones, but these ones. Because what this artist has been doing, and this artist is a very young artist from Kinshasa, it's Hilary Balu, born 1992. Oh God, you get very old. And he's sort of reappropriating, maybe not his ancestral heritage, but at least his heritage of the space where he comes from. And he tries to work with this concept of this spiritual loaded figure, this also this ambivalent figure that this Ninkisi is, and gives it a new sort of anti-Western critique. And in this way, this Ninkisi becomes so much more interesting to display because it says something about living heritage. It says something about new reappropriation of something that, because of Christianity, was taken from a lot of communities. Do I still have 2 minutes? Okay, one, because welcome to Jerusalem. I don't know whom of you saw this exhibition. It was very, very criticized, or let us say, you either liked it or hated it, to make a long story short, or at least it divided the community enormously, the Jewish community in Germany. It was a very strong public discourse and also a non-public discourse. And if you say you want to be a museum that reconnects stronger with communities, what does it mean that you show an exhibition that a lot of your source community is very ambivalent about? What do you do? Do you let the community get control? Do you let the community censor yourself? Or do you try to get into a dialogue and maybe invite a community to be more transparent in their critique and then create multi-perspective narratives within this museum, within this exhibition? This, of course, all happened, or at least not the critique happened, but not this maybe opening up the museum space as a dialogue and a forum to get into contact with the community that does have and had serious problems with this exhibition. And I'm not saying that the critique was just. I'm just saying it was there and should, if you take community curation and the community seriously, should we not have proactively engaged more with this community? I am sorry that we as museum didn't do that enough. But maybe some people will do that in literature after people have digested this concept. Okay, thank you. Because then I can turn to you both.
We can have a bit more time.
Is it working? Yeah? Very good. So thank you both very, very much indeed for absolutely wonderful talks with so much there. We could definitely talk all night, I'm sure, but we won't, because there's tomorrow coming. I'm not quite sure how long we do have to talk, so basically until somebody comes and forces us out, we're here. I wanted to kind of begin by asking you both about this question of community, which you just came back to at the end, Leontina, and it was obviously the biggest word on your slide with these keywords, and absolutely fundamental in what you were talking about, Jisgang. Community, though, as I think you especially indicated, and with those past examples, in some sense, it's a term that gets used to apply to different groupings, but then that's not necessarily a set of people who all will agree. There might be very, very big differences in what counts as community. And I suppose we also know from some examples that what gets labeled as community can sometimes be extremely conservative, maybe also in the ideas and expectations of what a museum does and should do. And I just wondered whether you might both have, I suppose the key question there then is, what's the role of the curator or the director in negotiating community? I mean, whose voices do you choose most? Should it be a majority, or how? And I wondered if you maybe even could give particular examples of that. If you, I mean, you presented very much a picture of a community that it doesn't have divisions, and maybe it doesn't, but there are cases where the women's hopes of what might be represented are not maybe the same as men's or something. And I wondered if you have any cases where you felt you had to negotiate community, or perhaps it's not never problematic, I don't know, but it clearly is in the, especially in the case you were mentioning at the end for you, Leontina. So that was my question, really, was just about community and what's the role of the curator or director in deciding who in some sense gets to count as the community, if that's what's being represented. So I don't know who wants to go first.
Is it on? That's a great question, but I have to just make clear, when you said I was a weaver, I didn't get to correct you earlier. I'm a beginner weaver.
It's good enough.
That type of question could take days to answer. What I will say is that we are a nation. We're individuals. We're humans. You could say we have defectors. You could say we do absolutely argue amongst ourselves. That's important. It's how it's done that makes it effective. And we're not perfect. We don't always argue with diplomacy. That being said, I think that when your population is reduced to the amount of people we had on island, there were about 400 in Alaska as well, and we don't know how many on the mainland, but on Haida Gwaii, you learn to band together. So of course there were disputes historically, even today, between clans. But when you need to survive and you come together, that can really, really, really impact the understanding of everything depends on everything else. I figure if I have at least 7 people furious at me from home, at any given time, I'm doing a great job. Because if I just did what I did and no one complained, no one's paying attention. I am an expert at nothing except knowing where to go. And I don't believe in elitism. I believe that everyone has knowledge and wisdom to share. I am taught and trained by my elders and other leaders, knowledge holders, and historians in our community. But it is really on a case-by-case basis. I think we have a luxury in our museum that we know our main community, and that's our Haida Nation, but also greater Haida Gwaii, our neighbors on Haida Gwaii. Is that okay?
Wonderful. Okay.
Well, of course, you it's always in plural. It's always communities, which is corny to say. But what I do find, what does ring a bell is that what you said, and what I tried to pinpoint at earlier, is that sometimes the community has a very conservative idea of what identity is. And it's not at all liquid. It's who belongs and who doesn't belong. In a Jewish context, it's either, is it halachic or is it non-halachic? And if it's non-halachic, then you're out anyway. So it's very much determined on who decides who belongs and who doesn't belong. And I would say that in Europe at least, but I think globally, we should look at who belongs to a Jewish community. Communities should be seen much more heterogeneous, much more open, much more inclusive. And then when you work together with the community, is the community then the Zentralrat der Juden? Is that the community representative? Is it somebody from the religious infrastructure, or can it be a queer initiative based in Kreuzberg? And then I myself would always opt for the queer initiative in Kreuzberg, but maybe that's because of the liquidity. But I think it's manifold, and you have to be very transparent in whom you're working with as museum and why. Because the Jewish Museum in Amsterdam, which is so participatory and so much working with communities, it's of course very much reform. So you see a lot of narratives of reform rabbis with a lesbian identity, raising Jewish children with their non-Jewish partner. I mean, an Orthodox rabbi, he would consider that difficult. But at least the museum in Amsterdam is very open to that, it's because it's also taking a stand. It's what we see Judaism as, double point, this and this. And if you can stand for that, then you can also sort of be very transparent in who you're working with or not. And in the context of the ethnological, I experience indeed a lot of communities that wants to be represented or have been represented in the museum. We have, for example, one Aboriginal figure dancing in our museum, a permanent exhibition at the moment. And when I saw that for the first time, I thought, oh my God, this is a living zoo, human zoo all over again. But then I spoke with my colleague custodian, and she said, this is what the community themselves want. And then I think our role as curator is negotiate with what the community wants and perceives of what this museum as space of representation is and what it can be. And that it's maybe a bit more static, very modernist in their perspective. But on the other hand, you also need to respect the community. So if that's what they want, then that's what they want. That's at least how my colleague reacted. So it's always this moment of negotiation and making it transparent. I think that's the key of what we should be doing in any museum, but especially in the ethnological and also Jewish museum context, is making our choices transparent and getting therefore in debate with the audiences. And if that would have been done more, I think, in the Jerusalem exhibition, a lot of the critique bonanza would not have occurred. So the method is the message, I would say.
That's a very nice line. Maybe just ask you one more question before opening up to the audience here. We talked about this term reconciliation, and you both threw that into question, and especially this idea that maybe it's being commodified in the sense that it, as I understood it, that it's being used almost as a kind of excuse to say we're doing work of reconciliation while all sorts of other very negative things are going on. I noticed that you both used terms of healing and repair, and so I'm wondering if that, though you think those might be maybe the key terms that we could use instead. And I wondered there as well, though, because I think you both presented that those as very central to maybe something that museums can do, and I suppose I'm wondering how far might they go. But also, do you think, could it ever be done, any full repair or healing? How far can one get with it?
Look how far colonization got. Nothing is impossible. At home, we've struggled a lot with the word reconciliation, even before the commodification. Is it reconciliation? Is it conciliation? Is it really reconciliation? Or are there such well-meaning intents, but have we looked at what does that word mean? You can't just say reconciliation and we're reconciled. At home, our elders and our way is tl'yahta, which is making things right or setting things right. In our way, again, just so no one thinks we're utopia, we're a nation. But one of our practices, I think I was talking with Kara about it today, that I've noticed in the outside world and in some areas in ours, people have trouble admitting that they've erred, that they've made a mistake. I think we have an incredible system at home, which is when you do make an error and you know it, you correct it on the spot. You say, I made a mistake. And it's a reciprocal relationship, so you pay that person in one form or another. If you don't know and you're told later, you publicly acknowledge, I made a mistake, and you make things right. And of course, it takes the other side to accept it. And I gave this example to Kara today, and what happened needs never to be spoken of again, but I like to tell this story because I think it helps hit home. I was emceeing, and I go to the hereditary leaders when I introduce them ahead of time to make sure I'm saying their names right if I don't know them well. And there was a hereditary leader who, he's got a real good sense of humor, and I went up and I said, you know, how do you say your name? And he said, oh, it's on my business card. And I was like, oh, well, yeah. So anyways, I went up, and of course, I tried to introduce him, and I said it in the Skidigit dialect instead of the old Masset dialect, which is quite different. I was reading it, but I read it in the Skidigit. I didn't even know I'd made a mistake. And immediately, one of my friends jumped up with a drum and started beating it. And another of my clan members jumped up with a hat, and a whole bunch of my other clan members jumped up and started throwing money in it, and we paid that hereditary leader $400 as retribution. I carry no shame. My clan carries no shame. He carries no offense. And really, it never needs to be spoken of again. Much greater hurts have happened, and it takes time. You work with both sides. You can't abandon the offender. You have to help the offender just as much as you need to help the offended, because that's the only way we can repair, make things right, and move forward.
What more can I say? Well, museums need to fulfill a lot at this moment in time, and museums can't, because museums are systems and with governing bodies, and so what we should do everything within a museum context, and we can't. We are only museums. They're great places to work with and in, but they're only museums. So, but saying that and saying what is being done in discourse, but also especially in a lot of community and indigenous museum context, bottom-up approaches, is that they have become spaces of empowerment, of emancipation, of addressing issues that would have not or were not being expressed before in a debate. And I don't believe in state organized sites of repatriation, of representation. That's why I was so not critical, but you know, slightly ironic when it comes to the Humboldt Forum that is going to be opened. Although I know the people, or a lot of people that work there, and they're all very good. So it's not about the people, the museum professionals that work in those institutions, but it's these places of representation, of power, of politicians then taking over, which is exactly what is being done here after Vera Bent sort of, you know, was one of the main drivers of this initiative to establish a Jewish museum in West Berlin, because Jewish, there should be a Jewish museum in West Berlin. So I'm quite skeptical in those places of those places. But on the other hand, if there aren't such places, then there's also not a public eye. So there is an ambivalence between the public eye and putting things on the agenda, and politicians taking over. I mean, I'm also happy that within the context of the ethnographical, this German ministers of culture finally met for the first time to talk about, you know, the colonial and repatriation and funding, possible funding. It hasn't come yet, but I hope it will. So we also need that. So there's this huge ambivalence also between in myself, but I'm a big believer in process. And if you look at historical museum discourses, then I now know that it takes a lot of time. And museums and culture in general are, but especially museum institutions, they're huge tankers, and change doesn't come overnight. And within a museum context, 20 years might even seem overnight. And I'm always, you know, too much a person with concentration difficulties, because I can't wait those 20 years, but it takes time. And I think if we now look back, or we will look back in 30 years, probably a lot has changed or a lot has happened in the context of reconciliation or repairing.
Thank you very much. So I'll open it up for questions, and I can see some hands already. I'm going to apologize in advance if I don't get anyone's name right, and I'm not going to pay you anything if I get your name wrong. If I wore my glasses, I'd have more chance of seeing who you are. But anyway, maybe you say your own names. That's the answer. So,
are these on? Oh, yeah, okay. I'm Sophia. I'm a student here at Humboldt University. First of all, thank you very much for giving us such deep insight in the work that you do. It was very interesting and gripping to see your presentations. I have a question that I suppose is for both of you. You gave us examples that I really needed of like successful instances of reconciliation, successful instances of like repatriation in like a good way. And I now kind of have a question that could either be really funny or really unpleasant, and I really apologize if it's the latter, and I kind of hope it's the former. But in terms of what was mentioned, Nika Collins mentioned the issue of commodified reconciliation. And also Léontine Meijer-van Mensch, there was some talk about sort of the sexiness of the Jewish Museum at some point. I don't know if you meant sort of the same thing, but kind of went in the same direction. And I thought it was an interesting notion that kind of stuck with me, because it felt like that was like even more cultural appropriation, because like the whole museum's taking objects as kind of the sort of epitome or standard sort of case of explaining what cultural appropriation is and how it works and what it looks like. And then I was kind of, I guess, left with a gap of like, what does it look like? What does commodified reconciliation sort of look like? Or like, how do you encounter it in your work? Sort of what role does it play? What's its role?
My sexy comment was actually very strongly related to what you were saying earlier. And that's now less of a thing within the Jewish context, but it's still there. And I hope it will, maybe that also takes a while before we moved over that context, at least in a German framework. It's very much a Jewish German thing. That takes a while.
Sorry, was it that the museum no longer is as sexy as it was? Was that?
I think the Humboldt Forum took over a lot of sexiness.
Okay. Right. Yes, yeah.
Because now we all discovered the colonial and the post-colonial, and which I think has a lot to do with people sort of trying to show that they're so good and they're so anti-colonial and they're so. Because I have in Leipzig the AG, a group of activists who do the anti-colonial, and they didn't want to come to us, or part of them, and said, why don't you want to come to us? Or my colleague asked, well, you have the wrong name. And I do admit that Völkerkunde Museum is a very, you know, ambivalent name. I would like to reflect on that, on how and if and when we should change that. But at least I would like to go into a dialogue about, you know, renaming instead of saying, okay, now we're in the Museum of World Cultures. So it's something that I would like to do with different groups. And especially also the communities of the audiences, communities of interest within each city, and I felt that there wasn't any real interest of getting into a dialogue with my colleagues and also now me, although my colleagues are doing wonderful work already for real long time, and at least you know, get to know the people, get into a process, start communicating. But no, everybody in the ethnological museum context is now the bad guy. And I felt it was not really about the ethnological or the discourse or deconstructing it, but it was more like we are on the good side. And I felt that intellectually so boring. So I said to the colleagues, you know, whatever. I mean, which is, of course, for me, empowering as an, you know, like, don't get yourself emotionally moved by such people. But if, so that was for me important to say to my colleagues, whom I really respect a lot. But it's, and I felt that was going on as well 20 years ago. So what is now happening at the Humboldt discursive context and the Jewish Museum Berlin, it would be interested to, a smart person should in a few years' time write an interesting PhD thesis about it. Also, the semantics that is being used in the cultural appropriation of the two narratives. And they're heavy narratives. I mean, it's intergenerational trauma, which you mentioned earlier also. It's and that you should never conquer with intellectual stupidity, or at least one-sidedness. I don't know if that's really an answer to your question. Probably it's not, and I'm sorry about that.
Let's not worry.
And I can give you a lot of what is, I think, interesting, and it is a sort of reconciliation, is that more and more there are discussions between those ethnographical museums with people that have taken care of objects and have gained a lot of knowledge and know the provenance of those objects, and that we get into touch with each other and start to have a sort of idea of shared ownership, and not of the object as such only, but also of all the whole intellectual property that goes with it. But that doesn't happen in the open. It's not something that the museums can point with in the media. But I hope there will be a more media discourse that looks more to such hidden sort of back office practices. That would be good. And in this hidden back office practices, a lot of repairing is being done on both sides. Because what I try to point out, when this group of Aborigine representatives of a group of Aborigines came to the museum, it was, you know, that you are in an ambivalent space. You know that you have been working with ambivalent collections. You know that you are in an ambivalent tradition. And that you are both aware of that, and that you take that with you in your professional growth as a museum professional. And I don't want to get into the whole emotional thing too much, but the way we are now working together, and I'm quite new in the museum, and I'm still sort of, looking how things are working, and it's also a bit of crisis management, to be honest, still. But that opened a door, an emotional door, that had a huge impact for everybody involved. And it was the secretary to the person who does the whole Dienstreisen, Abrechnungen, I can't translate it
travel
into...
Travel forms.
And the custodians, the whole shebang, high to low. And that changes the way an institute works with each other.
Thank you. Did you... Yeah, you're ready?
I just want to... many things you said struck me during your presentation, but one in particular is, who are you doing it for? So who decides when we're reconciled? But I want to say we've had many challenges. We've faced many obstacles. I could tell you hysterical stories, because we have to see our ways through. So some of the navigating with Indigenous diplomacy, yeah, there's some great backstories. Yeah. It's a process. It's communication. It's patience. And, you know, mountains have been moved, and it has taken, over, you know, it's been almost 30 years, right? Yeah, I have some great stories. I wish I could tell them, time-wise. But that's my question back to you. Mm-hmm. You know, first of all, ask yourself, who am I doing this for? And then who really gets to decide? I also want to acknowledge, I've met some pretty spectacular museum people here in the past few days, and I'm like, what's going on? You know, because I haven't had a chance to meet a lot of people on this side of the world, but we've also had, you know, challenges in some areas getting through doors, and yeah, like 4 minutes with you before we spoke, and Monica and...
the wonderful colleagues at the Humboldt Forum.
Yeah. And it's really wild to see where the minds are and the questions being asked. And that's what matters, right? That questions are being asked.
If we say we want to repair, and it's about reconciliation, then we need to change the structures of the museum. Then other people need to sit on specific and important positions. Other people need to be our stakeholders, or need to be on boards, and we need to change and reform the structures of what we call in Germany the Verwaltungsapparat. Because if I work with indigenous communities and they do, for example, research in archives in Australia for the context of the Aboriginal repatriation, we can't pay them officially because they don't have a German bank account. So if we can change that, and it's a tanker, and I know it will take time, so probably there will be some kind of foundation. If you said, okay, I found this new work of working, you know, this new curatorship important and participatory strategies, I have a bit of money, and then you can, you know, act accordingly. Because if you want to be this liquid museum, and it's not the, you know, it's not the five books of Moses, you can say a lot. You can critically reflect on the concept of liquid museums, but I also like it. And if we want to embody a bit of that in our everyday practice, then we also need to have different institutions that work differently. And maybe you can do other things because you are a community museum in an indigenous context, but in being this part, you know, being the state museum of Saxony, whoa, you know, no liquidity there. So and then you can criticize the museum from a theoretical perspective, but it's also, I also need lobbying to change those systems. So I'm doing that now.
I think the I'm doing that now is a really great kind of sentence on which to end. And I really apologize that people who wanted to ask questions, you didn't get chance, but we're giving strong messages. We should finish by now. So hopefully you can come and ask the speakers at some point anyway.
And not at some point. Right after this, we have drinks and food.
Drinks and food.
drinks and food.
Drinks
so
and
if
food.
You have worked up a hunger like I have, then we can go and continue this conversation directly and with conviviality.
Thank you. And
I want a
thank
cigarette.
Thank you, the speakers, very much.